Ray, Prometheus Health Energy Inc., Matthew D. Rabbit, Council for Appellant, Prometheus Health Energy Inc. Would Mr. Rabbit, when he approaches the argument, please state his name and
correct? Of course. Judge Dunman, may it please the court. My name is Matt Riffitt, R-I-F-A-T, and I represent Prometheus, the debtor and appellant in this case. Basically, the issues in this case are relatively straightforward and compartmentalized. The primary issue, without being insulting to the lower court, is whether the lower court indeed followed this panel's instruction on the last go-around. And nothing bothers...
Well, remember, it was a different judge.
That's correct, Your Honor. It seems like the luck of the draw here, unfortunately. The concern I've got is, obviously, I don't want to turn this panel and the lower court into a game of table tennis. That doesn't make any sense. But when you take a look at the proceedings below, what the court ought to have done, and I think I've pointed this out in my papers and I won't belabor it, but I think what the court ought to have done is taken a look at this case from the standpoint of what is the best administration of this case. It may have been pre-programmed by virtue of the prior appeal that the lower court focused on the issue of fraud. Well, if the issue of fraud was what was focused on, that may have been a correct path, but the evaluation that the lower court made not only achieved the incorrect result, but it had a faulty basis to do so. There are only two criteria, as the court knows, that were identified as indicia of some sort of prohibited fraud in maintaining the action below. One of those was comedy to the French judicial system, and I can make representations concerning what the commercial court in Paris knows about this case, but that's not in the record, so I think it would be unfair to do that unless Your Honors are interested. The fairness is how you define
it. We just have one, I think, question about the subsequent proceedings in the French court. My understanding was that the de novo hearing took place and that all that remained to be done was a decision to be issued. Has the decision been issued?
I've been apprised of two things by my client, Your Honor. I'll make this representation as an officer of the court. One is that the matter is under submission. I inquired yesterday to get the latest and greatest from Paris. Counsel in Paris apprised me that it is under submission. The Paris court is considering the evidence that it's received. The second is that GEMS Europe, that is GE Medical Systems Europe, did apprise the Parisian court of the existence of this action and its procedural status, and the Parisian court did nothing in response. So I do not know whether GE asked that the Paris litigation be dismissed as a consequence of the status of these proceedings. I do not know whether, as a matter of French law, it has any import. For me, the sole focus is American law and the due process and rule of law that's provided under the bankruptcy code and under the Ninth Circuit's jurisprudence. In this instance, I don't think, and particularly, and forgive me for citing the court's opinion in the earlier proceedings, but particularly if you take the instruction that this court provided seriously and you contemplate this case objectively and you don't speculate about what French courts might do and you don't make a conclusion that's clearly erroneous that U.S. trustees' fees had not been paid, if you sit back deliberatively, I think the conclusion you reach in light of the jurisprudence is that, A, bad faith is not established, and bad faith can't be a conclusion made upon a judge's intuition, I don't think, although that can certainly inform the facts. But B, the default then for the bankruptcy judge is, what is the best way to administer this case? Is there a bankruptcy case here? And that course takes you down a different line of precedent and hearing and offers of proof than a bad faith course.
Well, you know, the prior, I was on the panel that did the last one. I think I actually wrote the decision. It doesn't preclude the bankruptcy court from looking again at the question of bad faith. It just said that the findings that were made the first time around weren't supported by the record. So I don't think it's correct to say that we gave the bankruptcy court instructions, you know, whether or not to even think about bad faith or what way to think about that in.
I would agree with you, Judge Ferris, and that's my point. I think what ended up happening and why I refer to it as pre-programming is a case can be cast in a certain way. Okay, I've got a remand now from the Ninth Circuit. What do I do with it? And I look at it, and it's discussing bad faith. So as a natural human tendency, if you will, without getting into psychobabble, but as a natural human tendency, you would divert to that issue. Whereas the more proper approach, I mean, you can consider that issue, certainly, and I don't think this court, by any stretch of the imagination, said, we want you to consider whether there's fraud. I think you sent it back for the appropriate administration of the case.
All right, well, appropriate administration of the case. That's an interesting concept here. This is a debtor that has not been in business for 10 years plus. This is a debtor that has only one claim that's on appeal after having lost a trial both in the United States and in France. The claim, any recovery is highly speculative. And the debtor has no money to do anything. I don't think it would meet the standards for reorganization Chapter 11 because you can't propose a feasible plan based on a speculative claim for recovery in an appeal. The debtor is not under any collection pressure based on the record before the bankruptcy court, and the debtor and its counsel did not fulfill their professional obligations under the bankruptcy code. Counsel did not apply for approval of his employment, and there was no application for approval of employment of the counsel in France as special counsel. But here tells us we appropriately should keep this case in Chapter 11.
Well, I think, Your Honor, the questions you ask are good questions. They're not questions that were asked of by the lower court, and that I think is where the question should have been asked.
Let's throw in the other point, which was made in the findings and order, and not addressed in your brief on appeal, and that is, the claim that we're talking about arose in 2002. The debtor filed a prior Chapter 7 case in 2004. The asset was not disclosed. Therefore, it appears to be an unadministered asset of the Chapter 7 estate, and the debtor has no standing to claim it.
Your Honor, with respect to that issue, I think that in terms of our briefing, to the extent that the briefing is inadequate on that issue or utterly silent, I would welcome the opportunity to address that in briefing.
Well, you're not going to get that opportunity because the judge clearly addressed that point at length in the order, and it wasn't addressed in the brief.
And what I looked for, Judge...
It's waived.
Well, I understood, Your Honor. Here's what I looked for when I evaluated the judge's decision, mindful that I'm not the gentleman who litigated this issue.
No, I understand. You're a newbie, and I hope you get a nice fat fee from these people for having done this stuff.
Your Honor, I'm not looking for any sort of accommodation. I'm merely pointing out the problem that we have is the development of the record. And one of the things, in fact, that Your Honor pointed out is this notion of there being no application for appointment of counsel. In fact, there was. Once the lower court had given its marching orders,
there was for Mr. Broidy, not for French counsel.
That's correct, Your Honor. However, that wasn't an issue that was raised by the court.
No, but it should have been raised by Mr. Broidy if he were a competent Chapter 11 counsel. Let's get real here.
I won't speak to that, Your Honor. I certainly wouldn't presume to speak to a colleague's competency unless they gave me cause to. But here's the problem.
You have cause to presume the opposite.
But here's the problem, Your Honor. With respect to the status of French counsel, it appears to me that certainly the lower court could have made further inquiry. What we're not in the habit of doing, I don't think, is receiving a case and then a court which is actively administering a case, or at least charged with actively administering a case, albeit relying upon counsel to be an advocate for their client, or at least the interests of justice, that you would expect that all of these issues that you're raising, Your Honor, would have been properly disposed of there. Why? Because we want to have a record, particularly here, in which there's an identification of the issues, there is a decision that's based upon factual findings woven with the law, achieving the result that is required by the law. In this instance, with due deference to Judge Clarkson, I think that Judge Clarkson got sort of pre-programmed based upon what he had seen was the prior status of this case, chased down that road, and achieved a conclusion that, while we may agree with it on some level, is a conclusion that is extra legal. I don't think it's equitable either, because it doesn't afford for a full fleshing out of the record in this case. Now, if Mr. Broidy was deficient, I haven't seen any indication in the record from Judge Clarkson that that is the case, other than Judge Clarkson saying...
Well, Mr. Broidy indicated at the hearing that he would not be filing an appeal based on his colloquy with the judge. So whoever is behind Prometheus happily found you.
And that may well be, Your Honor. I mean, what I'm concerned about principally, with all due respect, is that what is the order that we have in this case? What do the statements made by the judge at oral argument inform us about in terms of where that order came from? And then I try to jibe that with the law. And I wouldn't pursue an appeal, obviously, if I didn't see a disconnect between what the judge found and what the law requires. Here the judge said, I'm dismissing this because it's bad faith. That's fine. But there has to be a factual basis for that.
So are you saying that, I mean, he did make factual findings. So are you saying that there's no evidence to back those findings, or that they're inadequate, or both?
Both, Your Honor, and I think he made findings that were overtly contrary, not deliberately, I presume, but were contrary to the evidence. You know, this notion of counsel didn't file their application. Mr. Broidy did.
The court recognized that there was an application for employment filed after the order was entered, and Judge Clarkson stated at the time that he felt most of the terms of his order to show cause had been complied with. So he was aware of it.
And if it were me, Judge Dunn, I mean, and again, I don't presume to wear the black robe here, but if it were me, the itemization would identify, look, these are the elements that I found in terms of indicia of bad faith, and this is why I think it's bad faith. There's a gap in the reasoning here. Now, this is not, and I think it's informative to take a look at the cases that have discussed bad faith. You know, my jet aircraft was repossessed. I file for bankruptcy to try and save it. If somebody's threatening repossession, I file bankruptcy to try and save it, and, you know, I mask the fact that it's a personal jet, this is just a sham in order to avoid creditors' collection actions. This case is quite different. Here you've got a debtor who is overtly going out and trying to protect the asset of the litigation against GE, ostensibly
right,
to satisfy credit.
Based on the record, as presented at the hearing, the original basis for filing the case was that the only way to continue the appeal fight in the absence of posting a bond was the bankruptcy stay. And that was wrong. Counsel admitted at the hearing it was wrong, because if they'd provided a certified statement of the debtor's insolvency, that they could have achieved the same result without the bankruptcy stay.
Judge Jen, the one thing that did trouble me, well, I'm sure there are a number of things that troubled me, but one thing that I think you're correct in pointing out that troubled me, and I think this court has to deal with, is whether Mr. Broidy made the representation that the only reason that this bankruptcy was filed was to avoid a bond requirement before the Paris Commercial Court. If that's the case, I would agree with the court, to the extent it's suggesting this, that that is not a proper basis for filing a bankruptcy.
All right, then.
Certainly is what he told the last panel.
Well, here's, when you take a look at the record, Judge Ferris, and this is what I looked for, because it did bother me. And I looked through the transcript of the proceedings before Judge Clarkson, and I noted that Mr. Broidy was not unqualified in his statement about the reasons for filing the bankruptcy.
Did he give any other plausible reason for the filing?
He did.
Was that?
For purposes of, beyond waiving the bond requirement, for purposes of protecting the viability of the claims against GE. Now, what the litigation...
Well, I don't see... That's a distinction without a difference.
It's a narrow distinction, Judge Dunn, but if it's solely for the purpose of avoiding the bond, that's a problem. But when you look at all of the criteria for being a debtor in bankruptcy, then you get context. And the criteria here is a obviously, based upon the financials that were submitted, based upon the monthly financial statements, obviously an entity that has a degree of insolvency or is insolvent.
Not a degree of insolvency, totally insolvent. Has no source of income and no operating business, and the only possible asset is recovery on this highly speculative appeal claim. There is nothing else.
Forgive my diplomacy. Let me just conclude, because time is short, with two comments, if I may. One, I'm not the highly speculative nature of the Paris proceedings I can't evaluate. That's not in the record. That's an inference that perhaps this court's making that I don't see.
You can make the inference from the fact that the same claims were brought by the debtor twice in the United States and France, and they lost a trial on both cases.
I have no way, Your Honor, with due respect.
The best way to win an appeal is to win a trial.
Well, that may be so in the United States, Your Honor. I don't know France. I haven't litigated before the Paris commercial courts. Until this case, I was unfamiliar with them and hope to remain blissfully so. With respect to the bankruptcy itself, though, remember, in the schedules, there are other parties involved. There are other unsecured debts. And the idea of using litigation as an asset of the estate in order to satisfy the whole, that is, the whole of the creditors, secured and unsecured, I think is a proper basis for pursuing the bankruptcy. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you very much. The appeal will stand submitted. You may call the final case of the afternoon.